in this video, I'm going to be talking about my Makita LXT 18 volt range of cordless tools. This was a suggestion by one of my viewers, Alex the Maker, and because I haven't had time to finish a project video this week, it seemed like a good opportunity to do this. The video will be split into sections, and the first section is why I chose Makita over some of the other brands that offer ranges of cordless tools. I'll talk about why I prefer cordless tools to corded tools. Then I'll talk about each of the tools in the range that I own and what I like and dislike about each one of them. Other tools in the Makita LXT range that I'd like to have. The tools that I wish existed in the Makita LXT range that don't exist, just in case anyone from Makita is watching. And finally, I'll talk about the Makita batteries and charger that I use. Why did I choose Makita's range of cordless tools as opposed to one of the other brands? Well, firstly, I'm not a Makita fanboy, despite how it may look in this video, but there are a good few reasons why I chose Makita. Firstly, I often see tradesmen and builders using Makita tools, and I've always thought that if somebody who uses tools all day and every day is choosing Makita, then that probably means they're good and reliable. Secondly, the selection of tools within the Makita range suited me better than some of the other offerings. As an example, Makita are one of the few brands that make a cordless random orbit sander, and that is a tool that I use a lot. Having said that, the Makita sander isn't one that I think very highly of, but more on that later. DeWalt have a great range of cordless tools, but they don't make a random orbit sander. Also, the tools tend to be a little bit more expensive than the Makita ones. The Bosch Green DIY range of cordless tools are tools that I think highly of, having owned a few of them in the past, but the selection of tools isn't as big, and I wouldn't be able to get every tool I wanted from that range. The Bosch Blue Professional range is bigger, but I haven't had any experience using those tools. Hitachi and Milwaukee also offer good ranges, but they're not as readily available here in the UK, and also I've not had any experience with those tools either. Ryobi have a really good selection of tools, including a random orbit sander and even a belt sander, but I haven't had good experiences using Ryobi tools in the past. Up until a couple of years ago, I only ever used budget tools, basically the cheapest ones I could find. And most of them were fine, they did the jobs that they were designed to do. But after a while, I just found myself wanting something a bit more reliable and better quality. I wouldn't class Makita tools as premium tools, they're not in the same price bracket as, say, Festool, for example. I'd say that they were more mid-range, better than the cheaper tools in terms of build quality and reliability and noise too, and reasonably priced. I think all of my Makita tools cost between £45 and £120 each, that's excluding batteries, apart from this latest router actually that I bought, which was a little bit more, and I think those prices are pretty fair. Finally, it was important to me just to use one brand's range of cordless tools so that I could share the batteries between them. Why do I prefer cordless tools to corded tools? The main reason is due to how my workshop is laid out. Most of the power sockets, as you can see here, are around the perimeter of the shop, and most of my work gets done here in the center of the shop where my workbench is. So if I plug in a corded tool, and I'm using that over here, I've then got this cable in the way of both me getting around the workbench and also my mobile camera stand, and it just makes things really awkward. Also, I like to be able to use my tools when I don't have access to a power socket. So for example, my circular saw, occasionally I'll throw this in the van, and this has been useful on a number of occasions. When I was doing my shed extension build and I bought some timber cladding from my local sawmill, it was only available in 5 meter length. So using my circular saw, I could cut it down in the car park and fit it in my car. I also used it when I salvaged a bunch of oak and mahogany from a local church refurbishment. It's also nice to have the option of being able to work outside in the garden if it's a nice sunny day, or if I've just run out of space in the workshop. Thirdly, I just find them quicker and more convenient to use. After taking a tool off the shelf, unraveling the cord, plugging it in, using it for a few seconds, and then unplugging it and having to wind up the cable again, doesn't sound like a big deal, but after a while, it just gets a bit irritating. I much prefer being able to just grab a tool, grab a battery, and then I'm ready to work. Next, I'll talk about the Makita tools that I own, what I like and dislike about them, battery life, performance, build quality, comfort, and I'll include links to all of the tools that I use in the description box below, and there'll be affiliate links too, so if you click on them and purchase something, then it helps to support my channel.
First is my impact driver. This is model number DTD152 in the UK, or XDT11 in the United States. This is the first tool I bought in the Makita LXT range, and I bought it because my previous cheap impact driver by a company called Erbauer, which I bought from Screwfix, stopped working after about 10 months light use. It happened midway through a project too, and it was a bit of a turning point for me. It was when I kind of decided that I needed to start investing in some better quality tools. For general woodwork and workshop use, I don't really regard impact driver as a necessary tool. Using a drill for driving screws works fine, but when it comes to more construction related projects, like building sheds and that sort of thing, it's great to have an impact driver for that. However, I do now use this for all of my driving needs because it's quicker for me to have a drill and a driver on hand, so I don't have to waste time changing bits. In terms of features, it has a standard quarter inch hex chuck, an LED light, it has a variable speed trigger, and it has a brushed motor. I think Makita make a brushless version as well, but that's obviously more expensive. The build quality is great, as you'd expect from Makita. This one's seen a fair bit of abuse and it's holding up well. It's very compact, so it's great for working in tight spaces. I remember seeing a video comparison of impact drivers, and I think Makita had the shortest distance from here to here, which makes it great for working in tight spaces. It's very comfortable in the hand, it's got a rubberized grip, so it's nice and grippy. Battery performance is good, lasts really well, and the price currently in the UK is around £55, or $65 in the States, which I think is a great price. Next is the Makita DHP482 in the UK, or XPH10 in the United States. This is a basic and inexpensive combi drill. It's not the most heavy duty drill, but for the work I do, it's more than powerful enough. It has the usual features you'd expect from a combi drill, two speed settings, drilling, drill driver and hammer settings, variable torque, a 13mm keyless chuck, an LED light, variable speed trigger, and this one has a brushed motor too. The build quality again is excellent, it's very comfortable in the hands, that's probably my favourite thing about it actually. I've got quite small hands and previously I had the Bosch PSB 1800 drill, which I thought really highly of because it was just nicer for me to use than some of the other larger drills. Battery performance is excellent, even on my smallest 2-amp battery it just goes on and on. This one's currently priced around £49 in the UK and $60 in the United States, which again I think is a really good price. This is the DSS610 in the UK and XSS02 in the US, cordless circular saw. This one cuts up to a 50 degree angle. The blade cuts on the upstroke, so it's best to make your cuts with the best side of the wood face down to minimize tear out. It has the cutting depth adjustment and it also has these markings on the blade guard, which is really useful for quickly setting the cutting depth to where you want it to be. It has a blade lock for changing the blade. It has an LED light. The motor housing for this is on the right side of the blade, so if like me you're right-handed, you have great visibility to see what you're cutting. A lot of circular saws, including my old Bosch one, have the motor housing on the opposite side and I don't like that at all. I like being able to easily see exactly where I'm cutting. This cuts a perfect 90 degree angle right out of the box for me without any adjustments. The build quality is pretty good, although I really wish that this blade guard was metal rather than plastic, as that's the part that's going to be resting on the bench or the floor or wherever you're working. Having said that, I certainly haven't been overly careful with this tool, but the blade guard is actually holding up really well, so perhaps the plastic is okay. I find it very comfortable to use, it's quite lightweight. Battery life is okay, it does get through batteries more than some of the other tools in the range, so I tend to use the 5-amp batteries on this one as they last longer. Price for this one in the UK is currently around £120, and it's around $120 in the United States, and I think that's reasonable. This is the Trimrouter DRT50 in the UK, XTR01 in the States. This is the newest of my Makita tools, so I don't have too much experience with it yet. I've only used it a couple of times. Previous to getting this, I used the corded version, the RTO700, which I really liked. And this is basically identical, other than the top having the buttons and obviously the space for the battery. It has an adjustable speed control, an LED light for extra visibility, and a ratchet and pinion adjustable base, which I really like. This is the only tool that I have in the Makita LXT range with a brushless motor, which means more battery life and a more efficient motor. The build quality is excellent. Like I say, it's just like the corded version, very well made. In terms of comfort, well, I never really enjoyed using a router at all until I got one of these Makita trim routers. I find it really comfortable to use. The one thing I would say though is on the battery version, I found that I need to hold this slightly higher up in comparison to the corded version. Not necessarily a bad thing, I guess it keeps my hands away from the router a bit. Battery performance I can't really comment on at the moment as I've not used it enough, but I should imagine it will perform well as it has the brushless motor. Price, this is quite expensive in the UK at the moment, probably because it's quite new. This is £170, but in the States it's only $112. So that's where I bought mine. I bought it on Amazon.com and I used a shipping service called Borderlinks to get it into the UK. This is the DMT50 in the UK, XMT03 in the States, oscillating multi-tool. This one I've had for a few months now and I really like it. I used to use this cheap corded multi-tool by Von House and it's okay, but using the Makita felt completely different. It seems to have much more power and cuts so quickly and it's just a real pleasure to use in comparison. Less vibration in the hand too and much less noisy. I'm a big fan of these tools. It's one of those tools that you're not really sure if you need or not, but when you have one, you just end up using it all of the time for all sorts of things. This one has adjustable speed via this knob. I really like the blade changing on this as well. You can just lift this lever up and take the blade out. And then to refit it, you can push this in again and push the lever down and it's locked in there again. Ready to use. You can also change the orientation of the blade to whatever angle you want. It's quite a long tool this, but despite that it's still really comfortable to use. Battery performance seems really good on this one and the price is around £90 in the UK or $120 in the US, which I think is reasonable, especially when you take into account how good it feels to use in comparison with the cheaper ones. This is the DJV180 in the UK or XVJ03 in the US cordless jigsaw. This features toolless blade change, an LED light, variable speed trigger, 3 settings of pendulum action, which basically moves the blade forwards and backwards as you're cutting, as well as up and down, allowing you to cut more aggressively through thicker materials. It also comes with this kind of soft plasticky removable base, which is really good if you're cutting something like a laminate and you don't want to damage it. There's one feature that this jigsaw doesn't have that my previous jigsaw had, which is the Bosch PST700E, and that's a blower function which blows away the chips as you're cutting so that it's easier to follow a line. One of the things I like the most about this is the visibility of the blade. It's really easy to see where you're cutting. I found that this cuts really well and accurately. It certainly doesn't lack any power. It's really nice to hold and use. It's got quite a lot of weight to it, but I think that's a good thing on a jigsaw, and it is nicely balanced in the hand as well. This one's currently priced at £111 in the UK, which I think is good, and battery performance is good too. This is the DBO180 in the UK, or XOB01 in the US, cordless random orbit sander. And out of all of my Makita tools, this is the one that I like the least. The main reason for that is that my old corded Makita sander just seemed to have so much more power and speed. It features 3 speed settings, which in my opinion range from not fast enough to even slower and even slower still. When you read the reviews on places like Amazon, everyone else seems really pleased with it, so perhaps I've just been spoilt with my old corded Makita sander, which just seemed to remove material really quickly in comparison. It is really comfortable to hold, although I do sometimes find myself wishing it had an extra front handle, again like my old Makita sander. Battery life on this one isn't very good, so I tend to always use a 5 amp battery. One thing I do really like about it though is how sticky the Velcro is on the bottom. On my old Makita sander, even after replacing the Velcro, I found that the discs would sometimes fly off. That's never happened on this sander, and in fact, I've been able to reuse sanding discs on this quite effectively. Price for this one at the moment is £93 in the UK and $99 in the US. It does come with a dust bag too, but I tend to use it with dust extraction. This is the DKP180 in the UK or XPK01 in the US hand planer. This one I bought mainly on a whim, to be honest, because I had an Amazon voucher and I had basically all the tools I needed already, so I thought why not? And it's been useful a few times, Could I live without it? Definitely, but it's nice to have. I tend to reach for a regular traditional hand plane before I reach for this, as I feel like I have more control with those. But for cleaning up rough material or removing more material quickly, it's pretty useful. The planing width is 82mm and the planing depth is up to 2mm, which is adjustable via this front knob. It has a vision panel for the drive belt, which means you can check the condition of it easily. It also has this spring-loaded plastic thing, which means that when you rest it down on a surface, the blade isn't going to get damaged. The build quality is excellent. It's very comfortable to hold and use. The battery performance is pretty good. I'd say it was probably similar to the circular saw. Better to use one of the 3 or 5 amp batteries. Price for this one is currently £130 in the UK, $170 in the US. So it's not cheap, and had I not had a voucher burning a hole in my pocket, I probably wouldn't have bought it, but I certainly don't regret buying it either. This is the DGA 452 in the UK, and I'm not sure what the model number is in the US, angle grinder. And I don't know an awful lot about these tools, but previously I've owned 2 cheap corded angle grinders, and this one is much more of a pleasure to use. Build quality seems very good again, it's very comfortable to hold, and I've really enjoyed using this. Battery life seems pretty good, and price in the UK at the moment is £82.
Makita cordless tools that I'd like to own. To be honest, I already have everything that I need and would use regularly. However, there's a couple of tools in the range that I'd really like to try out. And those are the cordless stapler and the cordless nailer. And the reason I'd like to try them out is it might be an opportunity for me to completely get rid of my air compressor, and that would free up space for other things. Both of those tools are quite expensive though, and to be honest, I've read mixed reviews, so I don't think I'll be buying them anytime soon, but I'd love to give them a try. Cordless tools that I wish existed in the Makita LXT range. The first is a belt sander. If Ryobi can do it, then surely Makita can too. I'd really like to see one in future, and for the time being, I'll just keep using my corded Bosch PBS 75A. I'd also like to see a faster, more powerful, more heavy-duty random orbit sander, something more akin to my old corded Makita sander. I'd also like to see a cordless power belt file from Makita, something similar to this one, which is what I'm using currently. This is a Silverline power belt file, and it's one of those tools, again, that I didn't expect that I would use very much, but I use it an awful lot. And despite it being made by Silverline, which isn't a very reputable brand, this works really well. Batteries and charger. Here are the batteries that I use. As you can see, I've got 2 5-amp batteries, 2 3-amp batteries, and 1 2-amp battery. The 5-amp batteries I tend to use on the more power-hungry tools, such as the circular saw and the random orbit sander. And I tend to mainly use the 2-amp battery on my drill because it's a nice lightweight battery and the drill just doesn't eat up batteries quickly at all. The larger batteries, such as the 5-amp and the 3-amp, come with a built-in charge indicator, so you can check at any time to see how much charge is left in the battery. That's a really useful feature. The 2-amp batteries, though, don't have that feature. So this is the charger that I use for my batteries. It's a dual charger, model number DC18RD, and I'll link to this in the description box below too. It's fan cooled, but it's not particularly noisy. It's also got a USB socket, which is really handy for charging things like your mobile phone. At the moment, I'm using it to charge my camera batteries.